Good afternoon.
I want to welcome you to the next in our series of webinars presented by CUES. My name is Brian Weitzel. I am a member of the marketing team at CUES, and I'll be your host for today. Today's topic, by popular demand, we have Eric Sebring back again to discuss the LAMP2, helping us understand how the LAMP2 system works. In a minute, I will be handing it off to Eric, but first, I just want to review the agenda. The presentation will be approximately 45 minutes. After the first few slides, we will be conducting a brief two-question poll to help us get to know you and better tailor our future presentations. If you do have any questions throughout the webinar, please use the Q&A box at the bottom of your screen to type it in, and Eric will do his best to answer all relevant questions as they are posted. At the end, we will have about 10, 15 minutes for any additional Q&A that is needed. And during this Q&A, I will be reading your questions to Eric and give him a chance to answer. We will do our best to get to all questions asked. Without further ado, I'd like to introduce you to our speaker for today, Mr. Eric Sebring. Eric, it's all yours, sir.
Welcome, everybody. Welcome back for those of you returning. A little bit about me. I've been with CUES for over 27 years now. Was lead in electronic repair for 9 years, did phone support doing troubleshooting with you guys over the phone for 12 years, and have been the technical school administrator now for about the last 6.5, 7 years. In the past, I've worked directly with CAT on developing maintenance and repair procedures for the CAT pumps for our grout trucks. Been doing a lot of work with the schools, redesigning them and adding new content to them. And part of this today is what you would see in one of our typical schools. As Brian mentioned, the format's going to be a little bit different today. Today is the Q&A going over the LAMP2 system. The questions that I'm going to be asking, I'm going to answer them. But if you have a question while I'm talking about something, feel free to use the Q&A and put the question in the box. And if it's relevant to what we're talking about, I will try and get to it while we're doing it. What is LAMP2? LAMP stands for lateral and mainline probe. It's the ability to inspect laterals from inside of the mainline pipe, having a second camera that can be launched up from the mainline into a lateral and inspect. Cable links come anywhere from 40 foot to 200 foot of blue push cable. So you can go from basically about 35 feet up in the lateral all the way up to about 195 feet up in the lateral. What is the light voltage from the K2? For the LAMP2, it's actually 120 volts DC. What is the light voltage from the K2 used for? The difference between the LAMP2 and a regular, say, OZ3 camera, light voltage is not only used to power the mainline lights on the launcher, but it's also used for the extend-retract motor to push your blue push cable up into the lateral, and it's used for the rotate motor for the camera head. One of the things that a lot of people don't think about is when you've got a camera sticking out of the end of your camera head and you're trying to rotate it, it needed to have a bigger motor in there. So we had to put a much beefier motor in there. So we actually use light power to power that instead of the, on the other one, it's just 10 volts that we take off of camera power. So the rotate motor actually had to be a lot bigger. So we actually use light power for that and for the extend retract motor. Transporter voltage from the K2 for a LAMP2 is the same as a ultra shorty or a WTR. It's 0 to 140 volts DC. Keep in mind that the LAMP2 is a non-steerable transporter and it only uses the left side drive to drive it down the pipe. What is lateral camera voltage for an SR camera? The SR is the self-righting camera and it's 21 volts DC. The camera has an overprotection circuit. If this voltage should go above 21 volts DC, it will shut the camera down. What is lateral light voltage for the SR camera? The lateral light voltage is adjustable from 14 volts DC to 27 volts DC. This can be changed so that you can increase or decrease the amount of light needed in the pipe. Now, I said it goes to 27, but the camera has an over voltage protection circuit in it. If you should go above 24 volts, that's as measured at the camera, it's going to shut the lights off. And when you start getting into shorter cable lengths, this is actually going to play into effect, because if you try and turn the lights all the way up and you're on a shorter cable length, you don't have the 1,000 foot of brown cable and the 200 foot of blue cable, then you're going to go over that 24 volts and your lights are going to go off. To get them to come back on, all you would do is turn the light voltage down and they will come back on again once it goes below the 24 volts. What pins on camera are camera power on the brown cable and red cable? Camera power on both cables, whether it's red or brown, is pin G for camera ground and pin H for camera positive. Now, when you're looking at the end of the brown cable, that actually has the letters on it. So you can actually see A, B, C, D, E, F, G, and H. But when you're looking at the blue push cable, it doesn't. So you're basically taking a mirror image when you're looking at the blue push cable. The other thing when you're looking at the blue push cable, if you look where the keyway is on the connector, you'll see that it sits between pin E and pin F. It's closer to F, so if we know it's closer to F, then we can go around F, E, C, D, B, A, and figure out where all the pins are. What pins are for light power on the SR camera on the brown or red cable? Light power on both these cables is the same. Light positive is on pin A, and your ground is on pin B. What pins are camera video on the brown and red cable? Video on both cables is the same. Video is on pin C, and video ground is on pin D. What is a push block? The push block is actually located on the bottom of the launcher. It has four sets of wheels that extend and retract the push cable in and out of the launcher. Now, this is one of those things that a lot of people don't think about, but when you actually are done doing a lateral and you pull the launcher back out of the manhole, make sure you flip it over and clean this out really good, because this is nothing but a giant collector on the bottom of the launcher, and it will get packed with dirt and debris and other things. So make sure that when you are actually doing this and you pull the unit out, that you turn it over and you clean this really good. What sizes are the push wheels? There's three different sizes of push wheels. They're labeled on the top of each wheel, standard, STD. This is the smallest wheel. OS, which is oversized, this is the next size up. The last one is labeled 2X. It's the largest of the wheels. The difference in size is only 1/32 of an inch between each one. Now, this is one of those things that we see a lot of people who are new or who don't understand what they're doing with this. And once their cable starts slipping, they will open this up and they will change all eight wheels at one time. We actually have a engineering document, and we will provide a link to it at the end of this on our website and stuff that you can get to, that actually shows the correct way to change these wheels. When you're doing them, you want to start with the bottom two on opposite corners, change those to the next size up, and go ahead and put your blue push cable back in and run it until it starts slipping again. Once it starts slipping, you'll take it apart, do the bottom two on the other corners, put your blue cable in and run it again. And once it starts slipping again, then we go back to the first set that we did the bottom on, change top to. And then once it starts slipping after that, then you do the other ones. So going from one size push wheel to the next is actually four different combinations of the standard and the oversized, or the oversized and the 2X. The other thing is, when you're ordering push cables, if you're only doing 30 to 40 foot pushes, make sure that your push cable is at least twice that length, because what you can do is once you start slipping and you've got the largest wheels on there that you have, you can always go back to standard and flip your cable over. They're exactly the same on both sides. So just flip it over and then you're working with a brand new cable again. How does the lateral footage work? Lateral footage starts with an encoder that's mounted on the back of the extend retract motor. As you extend or retract the push cable, this encoder rotates and creates pulses. These pulses are sent back to the LAMP2 PCU on the gold cable. And this is something else. When you're actually trying to launch into a lateral, you are going to hit things that's going to cause the cable to slip as you're going up in a pipe. So once you get to where you need to be, let's say it's the first clean out or wherever on a lateral, reset your footage. You're going to get a much more accurate reading of it, pulling it back than you are going forward. Because coming backwards, you shouldn't be catching on too many things causing that cable to slip. But as you're pushing it up in, it takes a lot of force to push the camera up into a lateral. So your most accurate footage is going to be coming back, not going out. What pins on the gold cable are for lateral footage? On the gold cable, pin 11 and 12, which is your right side motor drive on a steerable transporter, send the pulses from the encoder back to the lateral PCU. And we'll talk a little bit more about that later on. Okay, micro pan and tilt and mini pan and tilt cameras. What pins on the brown cable are light power? Light power is still pin A for positive and pin B for negative, the same as the SR camera. What is light voltage? Light voltage on both cameras can be varied using the light knob on the front of the LAMP2 PCU. Typical light voltage can range between 14 volts to 27 volts. Now, when you're actually using these cameras, we're going to set it to a certain point and leave it. And there's a reason for that. What is camera power? Camera power on both cameras is the same as light power. Light power is used to power up the camera. Because we're using light voltage to provide power to power up these cameras, we don't want to turn the light knob all the way to the off position because it will shut your camera down. Typically, when we're running the mini pan and tilt and the micro pan and tilt, we normally leave it somewhere around the 2 o'clock or 3 o'clock position. And I know a lot of the newer LAMP2 PCUs, they actually have a mark on the face of the PCU where that should be set when you're using those cameras. So what pins on the brown cable or camera power? They're the same as light power. So pin A will be positive and pin B will be negative. What pins on the brown cable are for video? This doesn't change between any of the configurations or cable type. Video is always going to be on pin C, and video shield is always going to be on pin D. Now, there's a tip or a trick that I teach in my classes. To verify that your video path is good, all you got to do is take an ohm meter, put it on ohms, and read across pin C and pin D. For a 1,000 foot of cable, the meter should read about 108 ohms. So just taking a meter and putting it on the brown cable on pin C and D, if you've got good voltage there, or good ohms, 108 ohms, there's nothing wrong with the cable. That's not where your problem's going to be. So you need to start looking somewhere else, either blue cable or your camera or the lateral PCU. What pins are for camera motors, pan and tilt? Motor voltage for your pan and tilt motors is pin G for ground and pin H for positive. Now, if you remember on the SR camera, these were actually our camera powers. So when we're connected to an SR camera, this is camera power. But when you're in the, have a SR camera hooked up or a micro pan and tilt or a mini pan and tilt hooked up, this is where we're going to get the motor voltage to actually pan and tilt the camera. Okay, what is motor voltage? Both of them use approximately 25 volts DC. I think the micro is 24 and the mini is 25, but if you're close to that 24 to 25 volt pin GNH, then you've got your motor voltage there and you're good. What pins on the brown cable are for communication? Pin E and pin F are for communication with both cameras. Communication is how we control the camera, pan, tilt, lights on and off, and turning the sonde on and off. Now, one of the questions that I got earlier was, does the lateral camera have sonde trace capability? And if so, to what depth? All of our cameras actually can have sonde in them. The SR camera, you can get it either with or without, but the micro pan and tilt and the mini pan and tilt both have them in it. And I believe the micro has both 512 and 23K hertz. You can actually switch between it in the firmware on the K2, and you can turn it on and off from the K2. Depth is hard to say because depth is going to depend on soil conditions. If you are in a place that has very sandy soil and it's dry, then depth will probably go down to about 14 to 16 feet. If you're in a place that has nice black dirt and it's wet, you might only get 8 feet down. So it's going to depend on your soil conditions, water conditions, stuff like that. I hope that answered your question. Okay, is the spring end field replaceable on all the cameras? Yes, they are. The SR camera is nice because it just screws right onto the blue push cable and screws onto the camera. Both the other cameras, you can replace the spring end on it. I believe it's either 6 or 8 small Allen head screws that you remove, pull the spring end off of the camera, and then there's a plug in there. You just unplug it and plug the new one in and reverse the process to change it back. Now, of course, with that, there's going to be an O-ring and stuff on there that you're going to want to make sure gets put on there and is not damaged in any way. And also a light coating of O-ring lube on it when you put it back together, just to keep any water from getting in it. Okay, lateral reel controller. Lateral reel controller sits at the very back of the truck, and I wish I had a picture of it, but I don't. But it sits at the back of the truck, and it's how you control the lateral reel. What voltage does the lateral reel motor use? The lateral reel motor works between 0 to 90 volts DC. What is the speed control used for? This actually controls the voltage going to the motor. So when you adjust the speed up, you're just applying more voltage to the motor. What is the force control used for? This is the amount of current that it sends to the motor. The higher the current, the more force will be applied to the cable when it's retrieved. We don't want a lot of force applied to the brown cable when we're retrieving them. Just enough force to wind it back up onto the reel. The reason for this, your gold cable actually has a working strength of about 1,000 pounds. The brown cable actually has a working strength of about 200 pounds. So you don't want to be pulling back your lateral launcher with the brown cable. You're going to be pulling it back with your gold cable and then putting just enough force on that brown cable to wind it back up onto the reel. Where should these controls be set? The CUES trainers quite some time ago came up with 10 and 2. 10 o'clock for the force and 2 o'clock for the speed, which for most applications, this is a very good rule of thumb. Sometimes you might have to adjust it outside of these parameters to make it work correctly. What I'm saying there is if you get into an area where you've got more silt or sand in the bottom of it, you might have to actually add a little bit more force to it to get it to wind up correctly. But the best thing to do is when you're pulling back, like I say, all of your force should be on your gold cable. And you want it to put enough force on the brown cable that when you put your hand on it, you can push it down easily. You don't want to have any force there. Just enough to get it to wind up on that reel so that it'll wind up correctly. How does the clutch assembly work? The lateral reel actually has a magnetic clutch in it. It sits at the back by the motor. For those of you who have actually seen the reel. At the back of it, there's a little flip-up door. And underneath that flip-up door, when you open it up, you'll have your magnetic clutch right there, and you'll also have your motor right there. So the magnetic clutch, when you place the reel controller in retrieve, in the front or the back, this applies 24 volts DC from the reel controller to the clutch, and it will actually activate the clutch assembly to where it will engage it. How do you adjust the brake on the lateral reel? There's actually two different brakes on the lateral reel. The first one will lock the reel to keep it from turning at all. This is the one that's located at the very back of the truck, right at the floor. It usually either has a yellow handle or a red handle on it. This one is adjusted at the back of the reel. So in order to adjust it, you just make sure the brake is off, and there is a small bolt there that you can loosen up, put a little bit more tension on the cable, tighten the bolt back down, or the nut back down. This will actually add more pressure to the brake. The second brake is a small scrubber brake. This brake is used to keep the reel from spinning too fast while pulling the cable out. To adjust it, increase the surface contact on the flange of the reel to slow the spin down. When you grab hold of the brown cable and you pull it at a normal pull, you don't want that reel to turn more than a quarter of a turn. So you'll just add a little bit more pressure to that scrubber brake that's on the side of the reel. When you're looking from the back of the truck, if you look up at the reel, you'll see it right there on the flange. You're just going to adjust it down to where it just makes contact with that flange, so that when you pull on the cable, the reel will still turn freely, but as soon as you stop pulling, the drum will actually slow down and stop. What does the release retrieve switch do on the controllers? This switch, when engaged, will activate the clutch assembly and engage the motor. It's nothing more than an open and closed switch. When I say that, if you've got your lateral reel controller set to front, all that's doing is it's taking a two-wire cable, it goes up to the lateral PCU, and you've got a release retrieve switch there. It's nothing more than an open and close. So you're either, it's like turning a light switch on. When you flip the light switch on, it actually engages the motor. When you flip it off, the motor and clutch are free so that your drum will spin freely. Lamp 2 lateral PCU. Now, this is a picture of an older one. It doesn't have the marking for lateral lights where it should be with the micro pan and tilt and the mini pan and tilt. And if you notice, this one doesn't even, it just says SR and P&T. The new ones say SR, micro, and then P&T on the other side. So why is the lateral PCU connected to the K2 PCU? Because we're using right side drive to get our lateral footage back from the launcher, we must have the gold cable reel going into the lateral PCU. Remember I said the footage comes up on the right side drive. Our lateral footage is coming up on our gold cable. It has to go into the PCU. We pull it off of the right side drive and send it over to a board inside of the lateral PCU to actually process it and get it ready to go over to the K2 as footage. We actually, on the back of here, we have the, it says turn block and K2 PCU. So basically your turn block will go down to your gold cable. The one that says K2 PCU goes over to your K2 PCU where it says two reel. Why is the lateral PCU connected to the K2 CCU? Again, this has to do with lateral footage. By connecting the CCU to the lateral PCU, once we pull the lateral footage from the gold cable, it needs to be sent over to the CCU to where it can be displayed on the screen. This cable already has our mainline footage on it, and we're just adding the lateral footage to the same cable. By doing this, on the back of the PCU, you see K2 reel controller. That cable would normally go up to our CCU. All we're doing is taking it off the CCU and plugging it in here. And then you've got K2 CCU. That's just a jumper cable that goes from there back up to the K2 CCU to get all that stuff back into the CCU. Where does lateral video connect to? Lateral video out leaves the lateral PCU on the video out connector and is routed to the back of the CCU and is attached to the auxiliary input on the CCU. When you press the view button on the controller, it will switch to the auxiliary video input inside of the CCU. Our lateral video comes out of the lateral PCU, goes up to auxiliary in. When you go into your configuration screen, you set it up for your lateral launch system, and you've got your camera selected, either SR, micro, or mini. When you hit that view button, all it's doing is there's a switch inside of there that is switching it from your main view to this auxiliary input. And that allows our lateral video to be displayed on the screen. I had another question that came in. It says, correct me if I'm wrong, does the light knob decrease and increase the frequency on the board sound in the camera as you turn the lights up and down? That is wrong. It does not. Yes, our sound works off of light power, but it will work anywhere from 14 to 24 volts. So it doesn't change the frequency of the sound. The sound is either going to be the 512 or it's going to be the 23K. Okay, what pins on the Molex connector on the back side of the lateral PCU are for camera power? With the unit configured for SR, pin 1, which is my blue arrow, will be ground, and pin 2, which is my red, is going to be positive. Using the mini pan and tilt and micro pan and tilt, this will change to pin 3 and pin 4. These cameras use light power for camera power. But with an SR camera, pin 1 and 2 is going to be camera power, and then 3 and 4 is light power. Light power and camera power for the micro and mini. I got another question. What are the hotkeys to turn the sound on and off? I believe it is Control S on the keyboard will turn the sound on and off. What pins on the Molex are for light? If you're running all of the cameras are the same for light power. Lights are found on pin 3, blue for ground, and pin 4, red for positive. Remember the light power when using the PNT camera is also camera power when you use any of the pan and tilt cameras. What pins on the Molex connector for video? For all cameras and configuration, video doesn't change. Pin 5, which is blue, is for video, and pin 6, which is red, is for ground. And then what pins on the Molex are for our communication? Only the micro pan and tilt and the mini pan and tilt use comms. And the signal is found on pin 7 blue and pin 8 red. Pin 9, even though it's got a pin in it, we do not use it. It's kind of like a chassis ground is what we use it for. So it's not really used for anything. Where does the lateral umbilical cable connect to? Okay, so from the 9-pin Molex on the back of the lateral PCU, the other end goes directly to the back of the lateral reel. I talked earlier about that little flip-up panel on the back of the lateral reel. There is a 16-pin connector on there, and that is where that cable goes to. There's no connections in between it. So in other words, it's one solid cable from the back of the lateral reel to the lateral PCU. That pretty much does it for this. Now we'll actually take questions, and if anybody has any questions on anything. Does camera tilt or rotation angle affect sound accuracy? No, it does not. The LAMP 2 system, it works great. There's some things that you learn. It's a trial and error type thing to where the more you do it, the easier it becomes to do. I tell everybody, learning how to use the LAMP 2 is an art. Being able to launch into your laterals, normally when we're doing this, we're going against the flow because it's easier to get it into. But there's times that you're going to have to go against the flow, and that makes it even trickier to get it in. Little tips and tricks that you'll learn over time is when you're doing that, if you're launching and you having a problem getting it to go into the lateral, a lot of times if you're pushing it it will actually push your launcher backwards. What I tell people is if that happens, let it push it backwards, 6 inches or so. And then with the camera still in the entrance to the lateral, drive forward. The transporter has a lot more power than the push block does to push that cable in there. And as long as you're holding the button forward to drive the transporter, it's going to push it in there. And the same thing when you're doing against or with the flow, you're going to find some tricky situations just trying to get the camera to go into the lateral. Now, the trainers do this a lot more than I do, but they can also give you tips and tricks on how to get the camera to launch in there. The biggest thing with the lateral launch system is you just got to take your time with it. It's not something that you're going to do as fast as you do a mainline. It's just not that way because you've got a lot more things that you're trying to do. Now, usually once you get the camera started up into the lateral, the rest of it's pretty easy. Occasionally, you'll get caught on things. The nice thing is if you're running a pan and tilt and you've got the little push rod on the front of it and you get caught on something, all you got to do is kind of pan the camera around a little bit until that's up against what you're caught on and then just push off of it with it. Same thing when you get to if you come across a Y in a lateral, you can use that little rod to actually decide which side you're going to go into just by rotating the camera around, putting the Y in there, and then rotating it back a little bit, and it will push into that lateral for you. So one of the biggest problems that I see with these is people don't keep the connectors on the blue cable and the brown cable and on their camera clean. I recommend that at least once a week, if you're using it, to remove the blue cable completely, clean the ends on both ends of it, clean the brown or red cable, clean the pins on that, clean the pins on your camera. It doesn't really affect the SR camera as much, but when you're using the micro and the mini pan and tilt cameras, that signal that we're sending down there to pan and tilt them is so small that if you've got any corrosion or dirt or anything on there, it's going to cause problems. One thing that I have seen on service calls is people think that they can put dielectric grease on the end of those cables. Do not do it because that's going to cause you problems. Those connectors should be clean and free of everything. There's an O-ring that should be lubricated with some O-ring lube when you put it back together, but don't put any grease or anything on the pins themselves. And that's pretty much all I've got. We do have some questions. Brian, do you want to take over?
Absolutely. So it looks like we do have
a handful of additional Q&A questions. This first one I think I can answer. They had issues at the beginning of this webinar. These folks are inquiring if a recording can be sent. The recorded version of this webinar will be live on our website within the next few business days. When you have the opportunity, visit the CUES website, cuesinc.com. The top navigation, we have a Learn section. When you click Learn, you can navigate down to the CUES webinar page. And from there, you'll be able to visit everything that we currently have posted. It looks like we do have a few more questions coming in, Eric, so if that's okay, I'll go ahead and read it to you.
Let's go for it.
When not using lamp 2, do we need to remove the wheels?
To get the blue cable in, the top two of the top wheels have to come out before you can actually get the cable to go down in. So yes, you are going to be removing them and putting them back in.
Next question. On the lateral motor, what is the lifespan per hours? We are running our trucks launching 25 to 45 houses a day for 6 days a week. And seems the lateral motor is burning out or grounding out to the body. Just trying to get a general idea of how long the motor should last.
That's a very good question. The motor itself will probably, if you're doing that many launches a day, you're probably only going to get 6 to 8 months out of that motor. Now, I know that in the shops, what's happening is that motor is actually building up carbon inside of it. And a lot of times they take the motor out and they will just blow compressed air into it. It's going through a dryer, so no water or anything is getting into it. But they'll just blow compressed air in there to blow the carbon out of it. And the motor works again for another 6 to 8 months. doing that many laterals. Municipalities tend to see every 2 to 3 years of having to replace that motor. Contractors, obviously, going through that many laterals in a day, it's going to wear out quicker than that.
Thank you, Eric. Next question. Did you say the light knob has to be adjusted from the zero position to receive video?
If you're running the micro pan and tilt or the mini pan and tilt, it needs to be set at 2 o'clock to 3 o'clock because camera power is working off of light power. If you turn it all the way down, there's not enough camera power there. It does need to be around 2 to 3 o'clock if you're running the micro and mini. If you're running an SR camera, it doesn't make a difference because pin G and pin H on the end of the cable is our light or our camera power at that point. The SR camera, it doesn't affect it. When you're running the micro or the mini pan and tilt cameras, yes, camera power and light power are the same, so it needs to be set around 2 to 3 o'clock on the front of the PCU.
Thank you. We do have a few more. Moving forward, does the LAMP2 camera have a sond as well as the push camera?
No, it does not. The reason for that is they would interfere with each other. So it's only in the lateral camera that you have the sond. Now, most of the trucks that have been built in the last probably 6 or 7 years, right at the back of the reel, where that 16-pin connector plugs in that comes from your lateral PCU, there is a line trace post. And you can actually hook up a buzz box to this, and basically it will electrify all of your brown cable, all of your blue cable, all the way up to the camera head. Just keep in mind when you're using this, you want to make sure your lateral PCU is shut off. You don't want your camera on while you're putting a signal on there because it runs on the video ground. The nice thing about that, and I know a lot of contractors use it, is it will trace the main line all the way down the street. And once you get to your lateral, it's going to electrify all of that cable. So it's a good way to trace the main line and all your laterals from the street all the way up to where your camera is setting.
Thank you, Eric. We do have another question, and I think it is it's appended to a question that was asked earlier. I meant when not using the LAMP2, do we need to remove the drive wheels, not the launch wheels?
Oh, okay. I see a lot of people that they leave the wheels on them all the time, your actual drive wheels. You don't have to take them off. Most of the trucks that have LAMP2 have a tray that the LAMP2 fits in, so you can set it right in there. Now, obviously, if you're running the larger wheels and say a 15 to 27 inch configuration, I would want to remove them because there's nowhere to put the LAMP2. And then you can just drop it in the tray without the wheels on it. But if you're using the small 6 and 8 inch wheels, both of those will fit in the tray that we have built for it. And I would leave them on there. I mean, chances are if you're doing a 6 or 8 inch, that's what 90% of your laterals are going to be in anyways. Why take them off and put them back on?
Thank you, Eric. Next question. Do you recommend Rain-X or dish soap or something else on the camera lens?
Rain-X is a good product and it works great. The only problem that I find with Rain-X is it's hard to get the window back to clear again. It always has kind of like a haze on it. So Dawn dish soap on my window in the summertime is awesome. It keeps any water and grease from getting on the window and staying there. In the wintertime, I actually run a 99% alcohol, isopropyl alcohol, buy it at Walmart. I put that on the window because it keeps it from fogging up.
Thank you, Eric. We do have one more that just got posted. Not necessarily sure it's a questionnaire, maybe more of a statement. External sound for mainline under different frequency works.
Correct.
Too. Yes.
Yeah. Our micro pan and tilt actually has the 512 and the 23K in it. If you're running just a standard SR camera or the mini pan and tilt, that both of them do 512, you can get the 23K little bullet and put it on the back of the transporter to actually find your mainline transporter in there. But you need to make sure it's a different frequency than what the camera is using.
Thank you, Eric. We do have one more question. And please, if you do have questions, feel free to post. We do have the time for additional questions. If you do have them, feel free to type your question in. Next question, how to change the speed when using the bicycle tires?
When you're using the larger wheels on the Lamp 2 and you put it in the configuration screen as large wheel, it does not have the ability to change speeds. If you were actually trying to change speeds, then it would go way too fast going down the pipe in high gear. And it would also damage the drive motor a lot quicker. So when you've got the large wheels on there, there's only one speed.
Thank you. What size setup do you set up to launch in an 8-inch lined pipe?
We make a wheel that is 4-line pipe. Instead of an 8-inch wheel, it's a 7.5-inch wheel that you can use on that. I know we make them for the CPR, and the CPR tires are the same as the Lamp tires. You can actually put the 7.5-inch wheels on there for line pipe. I would almost be wanting to do a 6-inch setup in a 8-inch line pipe because your chute is still going to hit and stuff when you try to turn it if there's any wrinkles or anything in the liner. We do make a 7.5-inch wheel that you could do. I would just be a little nervous about my chute catching on things in an 8-inch setup. I went over where should the light control be set to. In an SR, it just depends on how much light you need in the lateral. Gotcha. And that's why it's adjustable. You get into a lateral and it might end up being too much or too little, so you can adjust the light knob up to either give you more light or less light in there so it doesn't bloom out on you and you can see everything. But when you're running the micro pan and tilt and mini pan and tilt, it needs to be set around 2:00. And is that the last one that we didn't get to? I think it is.
Yeah, I believe that currently was the last question.
Okay.
I'll leave it open for a few moments. Oh, looks like we do have one more come in.
That's a good one.
Yeah, we got some.
How to set the strain relief on the brown-blue push cable. I teach that when you put your strain relief on the blue cable, it should be right up against the back end of the swage connector. And then lay it out flat on the brown cable so that your tow cables are tight. And then basically all you need to do is add about 3/4 of an inch more. You don't want a great big loop in there because if you do, it's going to get caught on things, especially inside of the reel. If you've got a big loop on there, it's going to bang around a lot and coming through the wheels, it gets caught. So somewhere between 1/2 inch and 3/4 inch, all you're doing is you're keeping the pressure off of that connector. For anybody who's done the brown push cable before, those wires in there, they're 24 gauge and 26 gauge, so they're very tiny. You don't want to be putting any pressure on them. And you definitely don't want that loop, if you get it too big, to be catching on anything because that's going to damage your wires inside of there. So somewhere between, lay it out flat and then add 1/2 to 3/4 of an inch and slide your strain relief down to that 1/2 or 3/4 of an inch and tighten it down. That's all the more loop you need in it.
Thank you, Eric. And it looks like we do have a few more that came in. Can you slow down for the large diameter tire configuration?
When you're going forward, the joysticks, and that's the one thing that I've never really cared for on the K2, is that joystick is so sensitive to try and push it to half speed. It's just very hard to do. You just have to learn to play with it and feather it instead of just trying to push the joystick forward and then holding it there. The nice thing is if you can get it to where you want it with the speed, you can always set the cruise control and go down to the next lateral at that speed rather than trying to hold it there.
Thank you, Eric. Next question. What size wheels determine whether it's Lamp 2, small wheels versus large wheel, and does the pneumatic matter or not?
Yes. The Lamp 2 small wheel is all of your solid wheels. Once you get into the pneumatic or the bicycle tires, that's considered large wheel. 6/8 and I think 10-inch configuration are all solid wheels, so that's Lamp 2 small wheel. Once you get above that and you get into the pneumatic tires, then you actually go to the lamp 2 large wheel.
Thank you, Eric. Next question, different topic. When using the compact pipe ranger, when pulling it out of the manhole, does the rear of the camera always come out first?
Typically, yes. I mean, unless you're in some sort of weird setup, once you get it in the manhole, you put your hook on there. Most people will actually grab the cable and bring the back end up, not very far, probably a couple inches higher than the front of the camera. Especially if you're using a lift, that keeps the lift locked. If you try and pull the front end of the camera up first, your lift's going to come unlocked and you're going to strip the gears in there.
Thank you, Eric. And again, we do have a question, and I think it is appended to a question that may have been asked prior. 6-inch tires with 1/4-inch spaces?
That would probably work in a reline pipe, yes. But like I say, we do make a 7.5-inch tire for an 8-inch reline pipe. We also make a 5.5-inch tire for 6-inch reline pipe.
Thank you, Eric. Another question that just came in. How to measure sag? Is that an option?
With the lamp 2, no. With just an OS 2 camera, we have the inclinometer, the OS 2 and OS 3, that will give you a degree of fall as you're going down into a sag, and you can find the other end of it by the inclinometer showing the other side of it coming back up out of it.
Give everybody a few moments for those last remaining questions if you do have them. So please do.
How do you turn the inclinometer on a EC3044? There's actually, if you go into the main menu and go to your setup runtime screen, there is a option in there to turn the inclinometer on, and it'll ask you what type of inclinometer it is, 5 degree, or I think the other one is 15 degrees. So currently we're using 5 degree inclinometers. So you just have to go into your main menu setup setup runtime display, and it'll give you the option to turn the inclinometer on or off.
Thank you, Eric. Has there been any talk about changing the lateral motor?
If we're talking about the lateral push motor, we have in the past. I don't know whether it's on the engineering board now to do it or not. It's something that, you know, it's up to engineering to do something like that. I mean, I don't know. I don't sit in on their meetings. I think that the motor that's in there works great for what it does, but it is something that we have had problems with the carbon buildup in it. Like, say, municipalities usually get 2 or 3 years out of it. Contractors, not so much. I do know that 90% of the time, it's just a matter of them taking and blowing it out and sticking it back in. It works again for another 1,000 pushes.
Thank you, Eric. We do have a couple questions that just came in. Moving forward, for testing purposes, do you have the lamp 2 connected in the truck to test the lateral camera?
You do not need it there. I mean, as long as your setup screen is on lamp 2, or even you can go in and put no transporter and auxiliary and just power up a lateral camera right from the lamp 2 PCU. We build test stations for customers all the time, and that's what they do. They'll just get a lateral test cable, which is LL306, I want to say, or 302 or 306. And they'll hook it up to the back of their lateral PCU to hook up their SR camera or their mini pan and tilt. But you don't have to power the cameras up, you don't have to have the launcher hooked up.
Thank you, Eric. Next question, how to measure sag in the OS 2 EC3041?
Again, if your camera has the inclinometer module built into it, you can measure a sag during an inclinometer inspection. Other than that, it's just a matter of, if you're talking about measuring how much sag is there or how long it is, it's just a matter of watching it when you go into the sag and when you come out of it to see how much of a slope change there is. The inclinometer measures in degrees. So, I mean, when you're going along and you hit a sag and you were at a, let's say it was at negative 1.2 degrees normal, and then you hit that sag and it goes to 2.5, you just watch the sag until you get to the other end and it comes back up and you go back to your normal slope that should be in the pipe, and you can tell how long the sag is. As far as measuring the depth of it, I know there's a way to figure out degrees. I remember all that from trigonometry back in school, but that was 40 years ago, so I wouldn't be able to give you a formula for it.
Thank you, Eric. Looks like we do have a question in regards to AI.
I believe it should. I mean, it's as long as it's in the database, it should.
And I think further down, there's another post, lateral video rather than lamp video.
Okay. Can't find the inclinometer option.
Yeah.
There should be one that says show pressure, inclination, or none. And you're going to put a P there for pressure.
Thank you. I think that's it.
Okay. Thank you, everybody, for attending. I hope I answered some of your questions. And as always, if you have any other questions, if I'm not in class, you're more than welcome to give me a call. My information's on the screen. I'll be happy to answer your questions for you.
Okay. Well, thank you, Eric. We do want to thank you all for attending today and hope you found value in our presentation. If you have any further questions or would like to talk to someone from CUES regarding the LAMP2 system, please feel free to reach out directly to Eric. His contact details are currently on your screen. You can also visit the CUES website for more information. Once again, thank you all for attending.